Florin does not need a lengthy introduction. The Jerusalem Post listed him as one of the world's 10 most influential Jews, the Forward as one of the 5 most influential American Jews. Let me just say one thing. If you invite Michael Oren, you can basically save organizing a whole panel. You get all in one, an outstanding historian, Princeton-trained Michael Oren, published a number of wonderful books, some of them best-selling books, History of the Six-Day War, A History of the U.S. Relations in the Middle East. You get a novelist, he published 2 novels. You get a first-rate political analyst of Israel and the Middle East. Of course, you get a diplomat, someone who I think conquered a lot of hearts of Americans during his tenure here in Washington as Israeli ambassador between 2009 and 2013. And of course, an active politician who right now is a member of the Knesset for the Kulanu Party and serves on the Foreign Affairs and Defense Committee. I don't know exactly from which Michael Oren will hear today, but I hope a little bit from all of them. As most of you know, Michael Oren's latest book, Ally, has also caused some controversy, both in the United States and Israel, led even to some political interventions. While ambassador in Washington, Michael Oren repeatedly called the U.S.-Israeli relationship unbreakable and unshakable. Back home in Israel, now he sees the relationship a little different, maybe more honest than during his tenure as a diplomat, and I'm sure we'll hear more from that. And not everyone has to agree with the conclusions of the book, but I would like to repeat what David Rothkopf wrote in Foreign Policy. Oren's book, he says, should be read and debated. Oren should be heard and evaluated in the context of his background, the role he played, the government and the society he represented, and the events in which he participated. And that's why he's here and why we want to hear more from him about his evaluation of the U.S.-Israel relationship. Let me also welcome the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, Peter Starr, who has been a major force in further expanding the activities of the Center for Israel Studies, which is the oldest, and I would say still one of the very active, the most active ones in the United States and worldwide. One of the reasons it is where we are is also due to Laura Cutler, our managing director, who literally works day and night for the center. I also would like to welcome, especially a very warm welcome, to Professor Dan Arbel, who for many years was the number 2 in the Israeli embassy while Michael Oren was ambassador. He gets a lot of credit in his latest book, and there's actually a very nice picture, big laugh, both of them in the book. For those of you who haven't read the book, another incentive to buy it. And we really very thankful also to our co-sponsors, Jewish Studies Program, and as you see from the banner, the Kennedy Political Union. Finally, we are very proud to have with Michael Oren on the panel, Dr. Tamara Vites, a senior fellow and the director of the Center for Middle East Policy at the Brookings Institution. Vites served as Deputy Assistant Secretary of State for Near Eastern Affairs from 2009 to 2012. Coordinating U.S. policy on democracy and human rights in the Middle East for the State Department. She also oversaw the Middle East Partners Initiative and served as Deputy Special Coordinator for Middle East Transitions. She was central to organizing the U.S. government's response to the Arab Awakening. The author of a book on Americans' role in building Arab democracy, she was one of the first recipients of the Rabin Peres Award, established by President Bill Clinton in 1997. Join me in welcoming both Dr. Vites and Dr. Oren, who will start the talk, and then later be joined by Tamara Vites.
Hello. Thank you, Professor Brennan. Thank you very much. Thank you to Dean Stark, to Laura Cutler, many times here. Thank you to many friends in the audience I see, Karen Annapolis, and to Leslie Myers of the Israel Project, which has been so kind as to sponsor my visit to Washington here, and to Tamar Wittes. I'm always honored to be on the same stage with you, Tamar. Always, always, always. So, as Professor Brenner said, this building brings back a lot of memories. Just before the end of my tenor here with Dan Arbell, my buddy in arms, I used to take orders from him all the time. I'm still taking orders from him. He told me to come to AU. I follow orders from Dan. I came to this building. You mentioned that there was an art exhibit that was actually someone had donated an art collection in my honor. Something. So I walk in. The last thing I expected was to be accosted by, I'd say, a 90-year-old woman who came up to maybe my pupik in terms of height. And she comes up to me and she says, "I like you, but I don't like your country and everything it does." A Jewish woman. And I said, "Madam, do you like everything your country does?" And she says, "No, but your country must be perfect." Now, those of you who read this book, Ally will find that this book, this story, makes it into the book. And it becomes the introduction for the most complex and difficult passage in the book. The anguished and sometimes convoluted relationship between Israel and the American Jewish community. I have a confession. The book, I was supposed to write the book in 12 months. I had to take off a month for Operation Protective Edge, in which I defended Israel in the international press in the summer of 2014. So basically, I wrote a 400-page book in 11 months. The 5.5 pages about the American Jewish-Israel relationship took me over a month to write. I had to keep on going back and ripping it up and looking again and pouring out my heart. And I felt there was a need to dig deeply and times painfully into these Jewish issues. And yet at the end of the day, it was only 5.5 pages out of the 400. And it was not the main thesis of the book. The thrust of the book was not about Jews per se, or even about Israel. It was rather about America. It was about America and its place in the world. And that is why the book's title is, as you can sometimes see, it is Ally. It's about America. And I deeply believed in the alliance between Israel and the United States. It's an alliance based on shared ideals, shared interests. That confluence of ideas and interests inspired all of my major life experiences. You young people should hear this. It really inspired me at your age to move to Israel right after college, to join the Israeli army, to serve my country. That inspiration informed my actions as ambassador during the 4.5 years when I was in this city. The U.S.-Israel alliance, this is the thesis of my book, the U.S.-Israel alliance is not just about the interests of Israel and the United States. The world looks at this alliance. This alliance is a litmus. It is a litmus in the eyes of the world regarding the depth and strength of America's credibility and America's dependability. Everybody looks at the alliance. And all of America's allies, Israel included, have a profound interest in maintaining a strong, credible, and dependable United States. One of the most illuminating conversations I had in Washington as ambassador, it was early on in my tenure in 2009, I had a private lunch with a prominent Palestinian activist in this city. And the conversation took place just as the new administration was publicly pressuring Israel to cease all construction in the West Bank and in Jerusalem. "It's terrible," the Palestinian told me. "We'll never be able to rely on this White House." And I looked at him, shocked. "But the U.S. position is exactly the same as the Palestinians," I said to him. You guys should be thrilled." And my Palestinian guest merely shook his head, and he said, "You don't see things the way we do. What you see, what we see, are people who are openly arm-twisting their friends And people who openly arm twist their friends can't be trusted. That's the way the Palestinians saw it. Now, speaking here at American University evokes not only the memory of that woman telling me that my country had to be perfect, it invariably evokes the memory of President Kennedy's commencement speech back in 1963. And I want to betray my age by saying, I remember it. Kennedy's topic, of course, was the Cold War and his heroic plan to reduce the chances of a nuclear war with the Soviet Union. He spoke about nuclear test bans and de-escalating steps, but especially about his vision of peace. It was a peace between diverse nations based on different ideas, but nations which succeeded in embracing that diversity. Kennedy spoke at a high water mark in America's post-World War II power. This was before Vietnam, before the burgeoning of the culture of self-doubt, which became one of the 60s' least appreciated legacies. Roughly a year and a half before delivering that speech, Kennedy had authorized the ultimate display of American might. The United States, he determined, was willing to go to the brink of thermonuclear war to prevent the Soviets from deploying nuclear weapons on the island of Cuba. The Soviets, as we all know, thankfully backed down. Kennedy's willingness to resort to massive force enabled him to offer a magnanimous peace. Today, though, nearly 60 years later, the process appears to have been reversed. America reacts to acts of aggression by signaling its reluctance to resort to force, relying on displays of soft power, on UN resolutions, on sanctions, and above all, on engagement. Now, many reasons have been adduced for this reversal, not the least of which is the war weariness purportedly produced by two traumatic wars in Iraq and Afghanistan among the American people. But the Cuban Missile Crisis, it should be remembered, occurred less than a decade after the Korean War, in which America lost some 37,000 soldiers. That is several times larger than the losses in both Iraq and Afghanistan. And a decade after Kennedy's speech, after America had lost 58,000 soldiers in the Vietnam War, and during the 1973 Yom Kippur War in the Middle East, President Nixon sent U.S. warships to go eyeball to eyeball with the Soviet fleet and again risked a nuclear showdown. And once again, the Soviets backed down. The Egyptians, impressed by this display of American might, switched sides in the Cold War. And that laid the groundwork for the historic peace between Egypt and Israel. Clearly here is the complex and politically prickly correlation between America's war-making and peacemaking capabilities. They are intimately and intricately and inextricably related. And in no place is that dynamic more controversial and potentially combustible than in the Middle East. Now, the first decades after the Second World War, the United States refrained from intervening militarily in the Middle East. Strategically, the area was perceived from Washington as being the bailiwick of the British and the French, the former colonial powers. But, and the Cold War, when it broke out, could be fought pretty well through proxies. Israel, Jordan, and most of the Gulf states on the U.S. side versus Egypt, Syria, and Iraq siding with the Soviets. In fact, that the only time that the United States truly intervened in the Middle East was during the Middle East crisis surrounding the Suez Canal in 1956, the Suez Crisis. After Britain and France invaded the canal zone and Israel captured the Sinai Peninsula from Egypt, President Eisenhower pressured his allies to withdraw, even under the threat of sanctions. This was despite the fact that Nasser had illegally nationalized the canal and had threatened to destroy the State of Israel, and Egypt under Nasser was a Soviet ally. The result was a disaster. Britain and France left the Middle East, they left it in America's lap, and Nasser went on to threaten pro-American governments throughout the entire region. 2 years later, American planes had to ferry British paratroopers into Jordan to save King Hussein from a pro-Nasserist coup. And British American troops, for the first time, had to land on the shores of Lebanon to save that government from a pro-Nasserist coup. Though the American soldiers never fought, they bought souvenirs on the shores of Lebanon. Fortunately, they did not have to fight. But then, in the early 1980s, everything began to change. For nearly 35 years, American forces have been engaged almost uninterruptedly in combat operations in the Middle East. Think about this. All of a sudden, and we watched it happen, American military fatigues went from being jungle Vietnam green to being brown and tan of the Middle East. You can see it in the airports around the United States. All of a sudden, the colors of the Middle East are walking through American airports. Now, some of these actions are better remembered. We pretty much all remember the Marines fighting and dying in Beirut. We remember the US-led coalition that liberated Kuwait from Iraq. We may remember the missile strikes that President Clinton ordered against Saddam Hussein. But less widely recalled are the two US bombing campaigns against Libya in the 1980s, the confrontations between the Iranian and US Navy in the Persian Gulf in the 1980s. And then came the post-9/11 conflicts. They were accompanied and later superseded by drone and special forces attacks across the region. And then the post-Arab Spring operations, beginning in 2011 with the bombing of Libya, and now air operations against ISIS in Syria and Iraq. And that, friends, that is the short list of America's military involvement in the Middle East over the last 35 years. America's more than 30-year war in the Middle East has yielded some crucial lessons about the use and misuse of American power. The United States poured $1 trillion worth of military muscle into a misguided effort to hold Iraq together. Now, speaking to a congressional subcommittee shortly after the invasion of Iraq, this is now close to 12 years ago, I recalled that Iraq was an artificial state. It was created by the British at the end of World War I to serve British imperial interests, and that the Iraqi state had always been held together by a preponderance of savage central force. If you remove the savage central force, I warned, the state would begin to unwind. The British had lost their stomach for it, and I feared that America would lose its stomach for it too. Now, back then I was speaking as an historian, not as a diplomat. And I have to wonder today whether future historians might someday conclude that America's intervention in Iraq not only resulted in the disintegration of that state, but it also contributed to the unraveling of the entire Middle East. Western historians might someday speculate, as many Middle Easterners are today convinced, that the humiliating overthrow of Saddam Hussein, the way he was found in a spider hole, the way he was hanged by Shiite opposition, undermined the whole system of the Arab state system, which was predicated to a large extent on a patriarchal type of leader, humiliated that leader, that father figure. So the first lesson is military power cannot achieve everything and may even have unintended tectonic consequences in the Middle East. But other and more varied lessons were afforded by the Arab Spring. Beginning in the winter and spring of 2011, the uprisings across the Arab world spurred a hodgepodge of American reactions. There were varying degrees of applause for the rebellions in Tunisia, in Yemen, and in Bahrain. And then there was military intervention following France's lead in Libya, ostensibly to prevent a massacre, but actually to eliminate Muammar Gaddafi, and then hastily withdraw. Political pressure followed to force Hosni Mubarak out of office in Egypt, and then followed by open support for his democratically elected Muslim Brotherhood successor, Mohamed Morsi, and then ambivalence at best by the ouster of Morsi, General al-Sisi. And yet it was in Syria, that strategic keystone to the entire Middle East, that the most pressing lessons can be found. Now, it has been well documented that President Obama consistently refused to become embroiled in the Syrian civil war. He talked about it openly. Both his secretaries of state and defense, the head of the CIA, and I contest the government of Israel, urged the White House to become involved. We warned the administration that the absence of American involvement in Syria would leave a vacuum that would quickly be filled up with any number of bad elements in the Middle East, including some hostile foreign powers. But the president held firm, even after the summer of 2013, after Syrian dictator Bashar al-Assad repeatedly and brazenly crossed President Obama's red line by using poison gas to kill his own civilians. Now, instead of acting on his pledge to respond militarily to that crossing of the red line, the administration settled on an Israeli suggestion for peacefully removing most of Syria's chemical arsenal. Now, that was an arrangement that pleased Assad's Russian backers, but which subsequently allowed Assad to barrel bomb his population with impunity. The rise of ISIS, meanwhile, has evoked strong rhetoric, but only a limited military response from Washington. I was on a plane last week. I picked up the Miami Herald. Folks of you from Miami, thank you. Great paper. Front page of the paper was a report that literally had my jaw dropping. America had spent $500 million to train the Syrian opposition. How many Syrian opponents had it trained for $500 million? Exactly five. One of whom had already defected to Al-Qaeda and had taken most of the unit's equipment with him. That's the response. Now, if the tens of thousands of casualties in the Iraq war, and I'm talking about Iraqi casualties here, presents a picture of what the Middle East looks like as a result of the overuse and the overdependence on American military power, then the picture of well over 200,000 fatalities and millions of refugees in Syria presents a picture of what the Middle East looks like without America in it. And the lesson in dealing with the threats and the challenges of the Middle East, America must find a golden mean for the use of power, neither too much nor too little. And that power must suffice to convince other international actors of America's seriousness. Because just as they're looking at the alliance between Israel and the United States, everybody's looking at the way America is acting militarily or not acting militarily in the Middle East. Tellingly, in early 2014, that is only 3 months, roughly, after the administration recoiled from using force in response to Assad's use of chemical weapons crossing the red line, only a few months later, the Russians interceded in the Crimea. Everything's linked. Everybody's watching. Now the Russians are sending troops and fighter jets into Syria, and as far as I know, nobody's going eyeball to eyeball with them. And finally, we have the lesson of the Iranian nuclear deal. Now, Israel's position has always been, was always, when I was here, the best way to get a good deal was through a combination of crippling sanctions and a credible military threat, preferably a credible military threat from the United States. President Obama's position was that it was either a diplomatic deal or war. Unfortunately, the Iranians never believed that. The Iranians believe that America did not have a credible military option. And even advocates of the deal, such as New York Times columnist Thomas Friedman, agreed that America was negotiating with the Iranians with an empty holster. It's quote unquote, with an empty holster. Now, virtually everyone in the Iranian debate agrees that a better deal was possible, and not only through a tougher negotiating strategy. A better deal was possible if America in 2015, as America in 1963, had been negotiating from a position of unambiguous strength. Now, these lessons will prove vital as the United States continues to confront rapidly unfolding and often seemingly monumental challenges in the Middle East. I remember being your age in college when the United States evacuated Vietnam. Some of us may remember. What's the picture we all remember? The helicopters. Pushing the helicopters over the edge of the aircraft carrier into the ocean. Everybody remembers it. It's emblazoned on our memory. Now, Americans back then, as they were pushing the helicopters over the side of the aircraft carriers, could be pretty confident that the Viet Cong were not going to follow them back to the United States. They weren't going to show up in New York, and they weren't going to show up in Ohio and Arkansas. But the Middle East is different. You can pull troops out of Iraq and Afghanistan, but you cannot come home from the Middle East, because the Middle East, whether to Ohio or to Arkansas, is going to come home to you. It's going to follow you. Now, President Kennedy's words, spoken here in 1963, have a poignant relevance for American policy toward the Middle East today. Quote, "We can seek a relaxation of tension without relaxing our guard," he said. "We do not need to use threats to prove that we are resolute. America must always be vigilant in the Middle East. And deeds, rather than words, must demonstrate America's resolve. And America must preserve its regional allies. As my book's thesis states, the world views America's alliance with Israel as a barometer of American steadfastness. Quote, we are bound to many nations by alliances, Kennedy declared. These alliances exist because our concern and theirs substantially overlap. Today, especially in the wake of the Iran deal, there is concern among many of America's Middle Eastern allies about the extent of that overlap. And America, all of us, must work to allay those concerns. Now, speaking as an Israeli, we, the State of Israel, we must engage in a serious and intimate dialogue with American policymakers about the ways that Israel can defend itself, the ways that Israel can deter Iran from the enhanced dangers created by these by this deal. These dangers include the upgrading of the 100,000 rockets which Iran has supplied to Hezbollah in Lebanon and which can hit every single city in the State of Israel, and if they are enhanced, their accuracy can be upgraded to within a five-meter radius. Any city, any home, any street, any school. Just last night, three rockets were shot by Hamas or some organization in Gaza at the Israeli southern city of Ashdod. Hundreds of thousands of Israelis had to run to bomb shelters. Thousands and thousands of children once again suffered stress and trauma from this. This is from three rockets. Not from 100,000 rockets, with far greater accuracy. There are now 1,500 Iranian troops that have been deployed in Syria, transforming our Golan border into an active military zone. And the terror cells that Iran is establishing right now, including recently in Cyprus, where they uncovered a store of explosives, Iranian explosives that were bigger than the charge that blew up the federal building in Oklahoma City. They're expanding. This is even before the ink on this agreement is dry. And these are the dangers. And these dangers include the indisputable fact that Iran can continue to be the world's largest state sponsor of terror, continue to call for Israel's destruction, and can continue to advance, to develop advanced centrifuges, so that when the deal expires, whether it's 13 or 15 years from now, Iran can create an entire arsenal of nuclear weapons. But as allies, we must do our part as well. For Israel, this means taking initiatives to change the status quo in the situation in the West Bank and our relationship with the Palestinians. We must renew our offer to negotiate anytime, anywhere, without preconditions, with the Palestinian leadership. It means restricting our building in those areas of the West Bank, or restricting our building to those areas of the West Bank, that will only be part of the Jewish state should we ever reach a two-state solution. And it means continuing to strive for that solution, however difficult achieving it may be, particularly in the current Middle Eastern chaos. A few hours ago, President Mahmoud Abbas, the Palestinian Authority, delivered a speech to the General Assembly of the UN I recommend you read it. It makes for very disturbing reading. It's a rant of 3 pages about Israeli racism and apartheid and colonialism and oppression, blaming us for all sorts of situations, including attempts to change the status quo on the Temple Mount, which are simply lies. Simply lies, and will advance the Palestinian cause not 1 millimeter. Not 1 millimeter. Designed to delegitimize us, to fortify BDS, to sue us for war crimes in the International Criminal Court, but it will not advance peace. There is no alternative to the direct negotiations with us to reach that two-state formula. Both the United States and its allies have a mutually deep interest in a just and genuine peace. So President Kennedy said right here in 1963 at American University. That peace will in turn be predicated on preserving those alliances and prudently projecting American power. That is JFK's legacy, and it is the lesson of the Middle East today for all of us, whether here in the United States or the State of Israel. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
I'm mic'd. Listen.
Are you fully mic'd?
I'm wired and mic'd.
Okay. Thank you for that fantastic overview. Mm-hmm. As a student of history, it is always a pleasure listening to your interpretation of America's troubled history in the Middle East.
Though I wrote this book, Power, Faith, and Fantasy, where I concluded that America had done far more good than bad in the Middle East.
You know, I was struck, actually, by your first lesson, when you said that America has learned that military power can't achieve everything, may in fact have unintended tectonic consequences. There are a number of critics of American policy in the Middle East here in the US, on the progressive side of the political spectrum, who would say the same thing. They would articulate that same lesson and they would say, you know what, we might try to use force in the proper way, but we're just not good enough at it. And we've proven that. That golden mean, it's a platonic ideal. Mm-hmm. So I guess my question is, when you look at that history and you see there's overreach and there's underreach, what does that golden mean look like?
Well, let's be very specific about this tomorrow. Let's take the case of Syria. And as I said earlier, beginning in the latter part of 2011, both the Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense, the head of the CIA, and the State of Israel recommended American involvement in Syria, that America be involved perhaps in not only training moderate opposition forces, but that America would create a safe zone within Syria, so that the deluge of refugees that was at that point flooding Jordan, flooding Turkey, we didn't quite see this point where it'd be flooding Europe as well, there'd be a place for these refugees to go that would still be in Syria, but this would require an American military commitment, certainly to keep the skies free of Syrian aircraft, to guard the borders, and this would have given America skin in the game. Would it have solved the war? No. And I think President Obama is right. There's no solution that America can give to this war. The solution has to come from within the Middle East. That is true. But by engaging in a calibrated way, in a prudent way, but engaging, it sent a message. It would have sent a message to America's allies in the region. It would have sent a message to some of America's challengers in the world, Russia being one of them, but not only Russia. It was only a few months after this that China moved in the South China Sea. Everybody's watching. And the message went out that America lacked that type of resolve. To me, that's what the golden mean would have looked like. We weren't recommending, I can say personally, Israel wasn't recommending the United States invade Syria, but that America had skin in the game. America could say it was involved. Now it is very difficult to do that. Now it's late in the game. The Russians are there, and just to recall history, back in 1970, somebody may remember here, are they old enough? During the War of Attrition, Israel shot down 6 Egyptian MiGs, and they turned out to have Russian pilots. We don't want to revisit that right now.
Yes, and I suppose that's why Prime Minister Netanyahu went off to Moscow
Indeed.
The other week.
Yeah.
Okay, I think what I'm hearing from you reminds me of a question Colin Powell used to ask mm-hmm. When he was chairman of the Joint Chiefs in the early Clinton administration, and they were arguing about intervention in Bosnia, which is, okay, let's try a limited use of force. If it doesn't work, then what? And then what? And then what?
But it worked. Hello? Right? It worked.
Yes, I think we can argue that in that case it works. Yeah. I guess there is always the challenge. You put your emphasis on the issue of American credibility. And you argued, I think, with good grounds, that not attempting and not following through on threats, for example, destroys American credibility. Withdrawal is harmful for American credibility. But attempting and failing is also not so great for American credibility, right? And
that's... I couldn't agree with you more.
Okay.
I couldn't agree with you more. Just a little side note. One of the revelations of an earlier book I wrote, the Six-Day War book, mm-hmm. was that, and I did research in the archives, the newly opened communist archives in Moscow, was that the Soviets in 1967 were deeply disturbed by the American bombing of North Vietnam and were looking for another flashpoint someplace in the world where they could divert attention from what was going in Vietnam, and they said, there's the Middle East. And there's a certain role that the Soviets played in precipitating the Six-Day War that was directly related to Vietnam. And there was there's actually an excellent book written by this, by Judith Klinghoffer, that shows the relationship between American policymaking on the Six-Day War and the Vietnam War and the way Vietnam impacted Johnson's thinking. It is all of a kind. It's all of a sort. The world was a small place back then. It's smaller now.
Okay. So let's posit mm-hmm. that America needs to follow through on the things it commits itself to in order to maintain its credibility. President Obama, in fact, I would suggest that maybe the only consistent component of his Middle East policy over the last nearly Iran. 7 years is the pursuit of a nuclear deal with Iran.
No question.
So wasn't it important to American credibility to follow that through?
Yes, but I think the credibility would have been significantly shored up had America negotiated from a position of strength with not an empty holster, but a full holster. And I think that better deal would have been achieved that would have allayed the concerns of America's allies. I mean, the Sunnis who are the people who are fleeing Syria right now are overwhelmingly Sunni, because they have concluded that America's abandoned them.
Sadly, mm-hmm. and a lot of Christians as well.
And a lot of Christians, people who have concluded that America has abandoned them. And if you ask, I don't know, this is a speculative number, but something in the order of 99.3% of the people in the Middle East believe that America has cut an historic deal with Iran, with the Shiites, and there's no place for them now. There's no future for them, so they have to flee. I don't think that's an ideal situation. For the United States, it's certainly not an ideal situation for Israel, not for the West and Europe. So with greater credibility, and the credibility that would have been born, I think, of an ability to convince the Iranians that when people in Washington said all options on the table, they actually meant it, that would have made a better deal. This is a long-winded answer, but our opinion was always that the Iranian regime was paying a high price for its nuclear program. But they were convinced that at the end of the day, that price would have brought them the program. If they had internalized that at the end of the day, they were paying a high price for naught, because before they got to the bomb, they'd be bombed, then they would strike a better deal. That didn't happen.
Okay, let me ask you, at the core of your talk today and at the core of your book, is that a strong American-Israeli alliance is important for America's success in the Middle East and obviously for Israel's success and security in the Middle East.
And not just in the Middle East, that was the point. Mm-hmm.
And if we look at the last year or so, all of which I hasten to say is after you left as ambassador. We see tensions that have certainly been more dramatic and some would say more severe than we've ever seen before. Now, the Iran issue probably manifests this more than anything else, but as you describe in the book, those tensions arose even earlier, beginning with disagreements over how to pursue the Arab-Israeli peace process. And I guess as we look here, we're coming to the close of this year, the United States is embarking on a presidential campaign in which, in different ways, partisan actors are using Israel as an issue. in a way that hasn't been true in our politics in the past. And looking forward, how do you assess the cost that the US and Israel pay for the politicization of disagreements over this last year in the course of the Iran debate? And I'm not seeking to assign responsibility or blame. I'm talking about implications.
First, let's say right off the bat that Israel has a paramount strategic interest in preserving bipartisan support for the state of Israel. I'm in Washington for several days. Most of my time has been spent meeting with Democratic members of Congress. And we have to be more proactive in reaching out, even to those people who disagreed with us over the Iranian nuclear deal. The progressive wing of the Democratic Party is very important for us, and we could do more. And I'm saying this not, you know, about the embassy here, Dan. I'm talking about the state of Israel in general. I'm in Knesset now, and I just wish I could bring three busloads of progressive Democrats to see a debate in which a recent caucus meeting. We don't have caucuses because caucus in Hebrew means coconut, but we have lobbies. Can't have a caucus, but we had a multi-partisan lobby meeting with left-wing, right-wing, religious, Arabs, Jews, with 60 transgender high school students. And the subject was sensitizing Israeli high school students to the challenges of transgenderism among teenagers. If I could bring three busloads of progressive Democrats into that room, they'd see Israel in a different way. But we're not doing it, and we should be doing it. And so what has transpired, not just in the last half a year, I think over the last 6 years, presents serious challenges to us. To us as Israel, I think it presents to both countries, I think it to America's position in the world. That's why I quoted that conversation with that Palestinian leader. And I think we have to work assiduously, seriously now, to redress it and to get back to a better footing. It doesn't mean we're going to agree on everything. Guess what? We're not going to agree on anything. We have structural differences between us. America, I'm going to shock you now, America's a big country. It's far away from the Middle East. You have the largest military capabilities of any nation in history. We are a small country. We're in the backyard of this mess, terrible neighborhood. We have very respectable military, more than twice as large as the British and French armies combined, but still, no aircraft carriers, no strategic bombers. Our margin for error on a lot of these issues is exactly zero. So we're going to have differences. We're going to have ideological differences, too. We have a big chunk of our population that views settlement in the West Bank as a divinely ordained and unassailable Jewish right, which is not shared, even by some of our friends up on both sides of the Congress. So we have those differences. We're going to have to learn to maintain this alliance in a bipartisan way in spite of them.
Okay. I think you and I have discussed in the past the changes in American politics and American society, mm-hmm. And the changes in Israeli society that have helped lead to some of this partisanship in the discourse. Certainly on the American side, Republican politicians have seen using Israel as a wedge issue, as a way to mobilize evangelicals, maybe peel votes away in the American Jewish community away from the Democratic Party. In Israel, too, we've seen the rise of a kind of populist politics that, you know, can win some points bashing the global superpower. It's hardly unprecedented in world politics for that to happen in other countries. But it's something new in the U.S.-Israeli relationship that a politician would see it as in their advantage to criticize the United States publicly as a way of winning a domestic argument. So how do we, given the imperatives you just described, mm-hmm. how do we overcome those partisan incentives? I suspect that some of the Democratic members of Congress you met with feel like the Israeli government hasn't done enough to counter Republican efforts to use Israel as a wedge issue.
Mm, that's very intuitive. For the record, you should know, in the 2012 election, the first YouTube video clip that came out and said the other party is anti-Israel was a Democratic clip, in which I prominently figured. little snippets of us. Listen, America and Israel are democracies. We both respect, you know, freedom of speech, we can't control what people say. But there has to be a distinction between what people say and the populist positions they may adopt and the reality. And the reality is such that there is no substitute for the United States as our supreme ally in the state of Israel. Is this not? It's $4 billion a year in military aid. It is diplomatic support. It's the diplomatic Iron Dome is at least as important as the military Iron Dome. It's 70% of the American population, which defines itself as pro-Israel, which is pretty much unprecedented. And the fact of the matter is, there's really no alternative to Israel for the United States, certainly in the Middle East, but not only in the Middle East. It's not only the army that is, you know, twice as big as the British and French armies combined. It's a little bit more now. It's not only that we have the shared democratic values and that we are unabashedly, unreservedly pro-American. It's the fact that Israel is the only country in this region in which the United States military, if it had to land 50,000 troops within 12 hours, would land in only one place, and that's on the shores of Israel. And it would not only be not opposed, it would be welcomed and facilitated. Where else do you have that in the world today? Think about that. And so we, I think, are for one another, we're the ultimate allies. That doesn't mean we're not going to have bumps along the way. We've had some very severe bumps. We have to try to shave them down.
As a politician.
I'm a politician. I haven't gotten used to that yet.
I'm sorry. As a politician, though, you see this up close and personal now.
Does that have the same negative connotation in English that you have in English? Call somebody, you know, politikai. It's like you could be a garbage collector and get a higher mark. Politikai.
You're a public servant in another form.
Yes, thank you. I'm a legislator.
You're a legislator.
And that sounds better.
Yeah, and I want to come back to that in a minute. But as somebody who entered voluntarily into the rough and tumble of Israeli electoral politics, you saw up close and personal in this most recent campaign how the relationship with the United States played out. And in fact, there were even some people who accused you in launching your book with the timing that it had.
Which I purposely timed it 4 months earlier to be
part
of the Iran debate.
To be part of the Iran debate, but there were some people who said that you were doing it for domestic political reasons.
That's funny. I know there were some people, but the book was already written and went to press before I declared my candidacy. So it didn't quite work out historically.
So as a politician then, and as a legislator, as a representative in the Knesset, how can you and your colleagues and your counterparts in the U.S. Congress counteract, push against that partisanship that uses Israel as a wedge issue, or the U.S.-Israel relationship
that's
as a wedge
issue? That I've taken to the Hill. I've met with Democrats and with Republicans over the last 2 days, and that's the message. We have to take it down 5 notches, and now we have to think seriously about how Israel can defend itself, how it can deter Iran. These are life and death issues for the state of Israel. These aren't abstract issues for the state of Israel.
Do your colleagues in the Knesset buy that it's time to ratchet it down?
Yes, and I think you've seen a lot of ratcheting down. It hasn't been much. I took some controversial positions also, as you know, about the Prime Minister's speech in Congress, and, you know, paid a political price for it, but I felt, you know, this was my duty as someone who had served here, and I understood how this played in America. The book was meant to be a contribution to a debate, which for us was an existential debate. And I felt it was our duty to get an Israeli narrative out there. It's an Israeli narrative, but I think if you actually read the book, you'll find that it is balanced, and there's a cri de coeur at the end of the book that says, okay, enough already. Let's stop calling one another name, especially in the name calling. There's a whole section against name calling. And I provided my reader with some concrete suggestions about how we can move to a different place. And I still subscribe to those. To those prescriptions.
Okay, I suspect that there are those in the audience who would ask whether the book, and more particularly some of the articles you wrote around the book's release, didn't exacerbate differences rather than bridge them. But I want to move on to one other topic before I open it up to all of you, which is where we go from here on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. In my own engagements, my own observations, and some of the discussions that you and I have both been involved in, it strikes me that a big part of the challenge for the U.S. and Israel in moving forward on this question is that Israelis themselves don't have a good answer yet for how to move forward when it is their judgment that they don't have a Palestinian partner that they can rely on.
I have a way.
Yes, exactly. Now, you've sketched out a path forward, and you just talked about restricting building to the blocks. Do you think that it's possible for an Israeli political leader to lay out a unilateral path forward that will win the support of the Israeli people and of the international community, including here in Washington?
The answer is yes, but it requires political space. You know, in our field, we talk a lot about space. One of the problems, and I talk about this in the writing, about the open pressure that the Obama administration put on Israel on the settlement issue early in the first term. It was a problem for us, but it turned out it was a much bigger problem for the Palestinians because it denied them space, diplomatic space. If the President of the United States is calling for a total freeze in the West Bank and Jerusalem, then Mahmoud Abbas could never join negotiations unless there was a total freeze. He couldn't be less Palestinian than the President of the United States. So he was denied space. That's why I said that we should have gone back to the understandings between President Bush and Ariel Sharon, which thought, okay, Israel can build in certain areas that are probably going to be part of the Jewish state, and maybe we can compensate the Palestinians in some way. Similarly, today, the Prime Minister of Israel needs political space. And right now in our coalition, that political space does not exist. Because there are major members of the coalition, they have my highest esteem, who would object to that policy. And they are, you know, from the right part of the political spectrum in Israel. The government would have to expand and have to expand in such a way that that more centrist elements would end. I'm in a centrist party, and I've designed the diplomatic platform of the party. We call for restricting the building to the blocks, to the Jewish areas of Jerusalem. But even beyond that, we can be proactive. We can be proactive by strengthening Palestinian economies, by extending freedom of movement. A couple of good examples, how long can I wait on about this? A good example would be the fact that we, right now, Israel exports all of Palestinian produce from the West Bank because the route from Syria is closed off. Our trucks are working at capacity. Without us, the Palestinians collapse. This is coexistence. But we should find other areas where we can coexist, not just in exporting produce. We can be proactive. And I think that inaction is not a prudent option for us.
Okay, so what you're saying is that you think it would be good for the U.S.-Israel relationship as well as good for Israel.
Yes.
For the Israeli government to sketch out its own path forward.
But we'd have to have what's called in our field tailwind.
Tailwind to do it.
Yes, and that you'd have to come from Washington. And often
okay, help me understand that, because it seemed to me you just said that the constraint is in Israeli domestic politics. It's in this governing coalition. The governing coalition would have to change. Where's Washington's role in that?
Washington would be helping Israeli leaders who do embark on this trail, and they're gonna encounter stiff opposition. Just a quick story. The EU foreign minister Mogherini came to Israel a couple months ago. She met with the prime minister, and she came out rather upbeat, and she gave this press conference where she said, the prime minister said that he's not going to build beyond the blocks. Now, I hope I'm not losing half of you. Blocks are, there are three or four blocks of settlements in the West Bank where about 80-85% of the settlers live. And the assumption is if we ever reach a two-state solution, those blocks would be part of Israel, and maybe there'd be some type of territorial compromise for the Palestinians, for the areas of the blocks. They're actually quite small. They're less than 2% of the whole West Bank. And so we say restricting to those blocks, we're simply building where most is. Most of the bedroom communities of Jerusalem and Tel Aviv. Nobody even knows their settlements. But so she came up very upbeat, and I went on TV with a member, a colleague in the coalition who comes from a right-wing party. And I said, this is great. This is just the way we need to move forward. My colleague said, we're going to break the government up over this. And everything's going to fall. We're going to go to election. The tailwind would be if somebody in a large White House not far from here would say, this is an immensely constructive move, and we fully support this, and we applaud the courage of Israeli leaders in making this move.
Of course, it turned out that wasn't, in fact, an Israeli policy declaration that Mogherini
it
was
turned
putting
out.
Forward.
No one followed it up.
So had the White House done that, I mean, of course, the first thing they would do is check with Netanyahu's office.
Right.
Is this, in fact, what went down? If so, we'll congratulate you.
But I can recall times like the Prime Minister's Bar-Ilan speech in 2009, where he came out in support of the full state, two-state solution, the moratorium, the unprecedented moratorium,
right,
to quote Hillary Clinton, of construction in the West Bank between the end of 2009 and Thanksgiving 2010, there wasn't the tailwind. And it created a difficult situation with the Prime Minister, where the Prime Minister internalized, I'm going to take courageous steps, but I'm not going to get credit for it. On the contrary, I may get criticism and continuism.
So you're saying that Netanyahu now?
It's very difficult for me as ambassador, because I'm trying to press people back home. Let's take the extra mile.
So you're saying that Netanyahu today is risk averse with respect to domestic policy. He doesn't want to challenge his coalition on this and go for a unity government because he fears he won't get the support from Washington? Is that what you're saying?
I think there are many, many factors here, not the least of which is who's going to join him. And some of the parties in the opposition have primaries coming up, and they have their own internal politics. It's not like they can wake up one morning and say, oh, let's join the government. It doesn't work that way. So there are many components here. My major point, Tamar, was that tailwind, you love that term, tailwind from Washington is really crucial here, that if Israeli leaders are going to take difficult steps, it's very important that they get encouragement from Washington. There were two messages that I always try to get across as ambassador to my interlocutors on the American side. One is that Israelis make concessions not when they are browbeaten, but when they feel secure. Make us feel more secure.
Or as Sam Lewis used to say, put your arm around the Israelis and bring them along with you.
Look what Bill Clinton did.
Mm-hmm.
Look what Bill Clinton did. Look what George Bush did. Both of them produced Israeli offers for Palestinian statehood. By doing precisely that, the second message was very simple. I said, try love. Because at the end of the day, Israelis want two things. We want to feel secure, we want to feel loved. Give us those two things and we'll go very, very far. I trust. Trust me on this one.
Even if the domestic politics in Israel make it very, very hard.
That enables you to overcome the domestic politics. There's a line that I quote by Netanyahu's negotiator, who you know, would say that about the settlement freeze. And he would say to the American mediator, George Mitchell, for whom I have the highest regard, he would say, you know, about the settlement, the demand for settlement freezes, that he would say, Bibi has to climb a high hill. Do not, at the bottom of that hill, shoot him in the knees. All right. Somewhere along the line, to make a Palestinian state, we're going to have to give up. We're going to have to give up territory that has been sacred for the Jewish people for 3,000 years. We're going to have to give up our biblical patrimony. Look at the Bible. Haifa's not in there. Tel Aviv is not in there. What's in there is Hebron and Jericho, Bethlehem. That's in there. And we're going to have to deal with the future of hundreds of thousands of Israelis who live in these areas. And we're going to have to take incredible risks because every place we've pulled out of, whether Gaza or South Lebanon, has become an arsenal for Iranian-backed terrorists who fire 20,000 rockets at us. So you're asking us to do an awful lot, an awful lot. The least you can do to say to us is, you know, love. Hug. We're with you.
Okay, so if we see Obama with his arm around Netanyahu at the White House on November 9th, then we know there's hope for the peace process. So says Michael Oren. Let me open it up to all of you. There are two microphones down here in front. I'm going to ask you please to restrict yourself to one brief question. And I know as well that we're taking questions from Twitter, Michael, because this is a 21st century campus.
Oh, boy.
So Laura Cutler may Hello. Chime in with a question from Twitter.
Right now.
While you're doing that, let me just acknowledge two great friends in the audience, Elon and Ava Blutinger. Elon, though he looks 20 years younger than I was in my eighth grade class.
That's because he was smart enough to stay out of politics.
American University class 1992, right?
Right.
Welcome back, Elon.
Welcome back, Elon.
Okay, why don't we start with you?
Thank you. My name is Ryan Fedashik. I'm a freshman here at American University in the School of International Service. Thank you for this opportunity. My question is, so to what extent do you believe that Hamas, as a political organization, as opposed to the Al-Qassam Brigades, is capable of being involved in any sort of negotiation for a two-state solution? Because it seems to me, as an outsider's perspective, that there's been a lot of negotiation with the PLO, but Hamas, it seems at least open, from what I understand, as Al-Zahar left it in 2006, to at least be able to recognize the state of Israel and maybe be interested in a two-state solution. Do you think that's possible? Do you think they deserve a place at the negotiating table?
The answer is no, but I have to qualify the no. Okay. No, is Hamas's position is Israel must go. And Hamas is willing to the best of my knowledge, perhaps talk about a 10-year ceasefire. It would even accept a two-state situation, which is not a two-state solution, because it has to be a one-state solution for Hamas. And that one state begins with Palestine and expands out. It's a regional Islamic state that could potentially be a global. They are a Salafist organization. And in that way, they're no different than ISIS. They may have different modus operandi than ISIS, but they're the same theology in many ways. It is very important when originally it was the Bush administration, but it carried on to the Obama administration, there were three conditions for Hamas joining a peace process. One was accepting Israel's existence, accepting pre-existing agreements between Israel and the Palestinians, above all the Oslo Accords of 1993, and disavowing terror. To this day, Hamas has not accepted those three conditions. It was very important. This is now going back. It starts in the Carter administration, but it reaches an apogee under the Clinton administration, that the PLO had a very similar outlook, but they kept the PLO's feet to the fire, as it were. They made them accept those conditions, accepting Israel, disavowing terror, accepting previous agreements, particularly it was Resolution 242, and that laid the groundwork for the Oslo Accords. Without that, the PLO never would have been an interlocutor. I hope it will continue to be an interlocutor. I'm not sure after today's speech. But that's it. It's very important that the United States and its European allies, the quartet, maintain these three conditions. Because without that, we will create a situation of what we parents call reinforcing behavior. It'll actually convince Hamas to move away from the table.
Michael, let me follow up on that, because there are some who would say that with Hamas in control of Gaza, they've proven that Israel is rewarding their behavior. Every time they send rockets over, yes, Israel bombs them, but then there's a ceasefire with agreements on access of goods and renewed aid and so on. And so there are some who say that Israel's showing them that violence works.
Are you a member of an extreme right-wing Israeli party? Because that's the position of the Israeli, of people on the Israeli right.
Right.
No, I know it quite well. There are even some people in Israel who think, let Hamas take over the West Bank. You know, they've proved to be, they're pretty uncorrupt as opposed to the current government there in Ramallah. And they, you know, you can deal with them. Okay, we won't have a two-state solution. They don't want a two-state solution. So there's actually a dovetailing position. We on the right don't want a two-state solution. They don't want a two-state solution.
At least they're honest, they say. At least they're honest, yeah.
So strange bedfellows yet again in the Middle East. The Middle East makes all sorts of strange bedfellows. I've seen how in this country the libertarians and the progressive left are both against American military involvement in the Middle East. Strange bedfellows. So the answer is, actually, they haven't been rewarded now. There have been a lot of pledges to help rebuild Gaza, but they haven't gone through. My first meeting in the White House was in May of 2009, and the issue was supplies of concrete to Hamas, to Gaza, to rebuild Gaza.
What about prisoner releases, which Israel has engaged in?
I think now we have a real debate that it wasn't a good idea. But let's just talk about concrete.
Mm-hmm.
The president and his advisors put tremendous pressure on us to let concrete into Gaza to rebuild the structures that were destroyed in the 2008-2009 Cast-Lead operation. And we relented. We let it in, and we saw what happened. The concrete went to building tunnels and other bunkers. And during the summer of 2004, Dennis Ross, who was present at that meeting, said, we made a mistake. We shouldn't have pressured Israel. So we have to derive lessons from that. And be very, very cautious. I'm going to say something that's going to surprise you. In the summer of 2014, Hamas tried mightily to ignite a third intifada on the West Bank. It did not succeed. It did not succeed because the Palestinians of the West Bank understood that they had too much to lose. Israel has an interest in Palestinians who believe they have too much to lose. Mm-hmm. There is a confluence of interests, not strange bedfellows. We have an interest that the people of Gaza conclude that they have too much to lose. How we can create that system without empowering Hamas, which will cause them to lose things, is the big question we're facing right now. And I don't want to in any way dissemble and say that that's an easy question. It's not.
Thank you for your time.
Right over here. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Alana Friedman. My boss, Lee, he says hi. I work at the embassy.
Oh, Lee? Yes.
Yeah, Lee says hi. What are some tools as a diplomat in communication that you use that you think are very powerful and useful in day-to-day life?
Tools of a diplomat?
Communication, something that maybe people would be surprised to know that you use, communication tools, that sort of thing.
Do you tweet, Michael?
I tweet. So once upon a time, when the institution of diplomacy was created, in the Middle Ages, ambassadors would be sent by their courts to some foreign court, take them 3 months to get there, they send letters back and forth, they would hang around the court, they'd whisper around the court, they'd try to get in the king's ear. And that was the job of an ambassador, was really communicating between kings. And then there was a new age where kings or presidents or prime ministers could pick up the phone and they could video conference one another. Who needed the ambassador? It's a position that's outlived its purpose. But in fact, just the opposite is the case. The role of ambassador has become infinitely more important today because you don't just represent your president or king or prime minister. You represent your people, your country. And you represent your people in your country, not just to a court, but to an entire population. And you do this through many means. You can pick up and, you know, get on a plane and go places you couldn't do in the 15th century. And I went to cities across the United States and met with different communities all the time. And you can reach out to the media. And the media is becoming increasingly important, not less important, as you know.
Yeah.
That's the ambassadorial role today. And yes, every once in a while you do carry a message from your prime minister to a president. That still pertains. But now the role of ambassadors is far more multifaceted, and I believe more crucial than at any time in history.
Some would say that in particular, the position of Israeli ambassador in Washington has always been at least as much about being ambassador to the American Jewish community.
Yes.
As about being ambassador to the White House.
I want to tell you what percentage of my time that part of the role took. Because there, as I state in this book, there is not one American Jewish community. There are many American Jewish communities, and keeping them on some type of one page was not always the easiest challenge that I faced. And there's one line in the book which I said, you know, I sat with American Jews who would not sing Hatikvah because it didn't mention the Palestinians, and I sat with other American Jewish groups who would not sing Hatikvah because it didn't mention God. And you had to somehow sit with all these people. But what I say to Israelis in Hebrew is, we are a small country, we don't have a hinterland. Our hinterland is the Jewish people. And sometimes it's a rocky hinterland, but it's a hinterland. And we have to do our utmost to preserve it. Other than that, we're a country that's 8 miles wide. On the eastern littoral of the Mediterranean and surrounded by a lot of bad guys. So we have to preserve it, as difficult as it sometimes is.
Okay, I'm going to take a couple of questions in turn with your permission.
Please, yeah, I can
let's start here, and then you have one from Twitter, Laura, that you want to bring in. So please, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Ian Gansler. I'm a junior in the School of Public Affairs. I want to thank you for coming. So in terms of the Iran deal, you spoke at great length about how what I can understand, we want a better deal to prevent Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons. So the way I see it, at least, is there are three options. There's the deal we have now, there's no deal, or there's a better deal. And it seems your opinion is that in order to get a better deal, the U.S. needs to have a gun in its holster. What exactly does that look like? Does that mean putting an aircraft carrier in the Persian Gulf? Does that mean intervening in Syria? Essentially, you know, to respond to Americans who don't want to use force against Iran, who don't want to to have to send American troops into the Middle East when we don't have to, how do we get that better deal?
Okay, thank you.
Sort of a moot point. Oh, you want to be asking?
If you don't mind,
please,
let's take it. Go ahead.
Okay, I have a few questions from Twitter, but I'll just ask one from Max. If Likud and Kulanu are serious about hoping to slow settlement development, then why join a coalition with Shas Jewish Home? And I'm sure you are prepared to answer that question.
I never get that question. Yeah,
okay, so a question on the coalition in which your party sits, and you know, our Sunni allies in the region would say the place to push back on Iran, the place to demonstrate American credibility, the way to get to make the nuclear deal as a fait accompli work as well as possible is to oust Bashar Assad, get in there and do it.
I like that.
You like that?
I like that. No, listen, it's not that ISIS is Israel's dream neighbor, but ISIS right now is really a bunch of people with flatback trucks and machine guns. Assad is the strategic keystone in an arch that extends from Tehran to Beirut and includes 100,000 rockets on the Iranian nuclear program. So it's ISIS, Assad, ISIS, Assad. For us, it's Assad. And always was, by the way. It never changed. Mm-hmm. Let me respond to this. It's sort of a moot point now because the deal is a reality. What would have worked better, what a better deal would have looked like, I could spend a lot of time. What I will say is that a credible military threat is a paradox, particularly in the Middle East. It's a paradox because the more credible it is, the less chance you'll actually have to use it. And it's paradoxical because if you do have to use it, the earlier you use it, the lesser extent you'll have to actualize it than if you wait longer. And that was an important paradox to internalize, which was very difficult in given the climate in this country because of the war weariness. Trying to convince people that the more credible it is, the less chance you have to use it. Right now, my fear is that this agreement has enhanced the chance for war, not lessened the chance for war. And it's not about nuclear war right now, but it is about, say, the 100,000 rockets with enhanced capabilities, which will present Israel with the first strategic conventional threat we have faced since 1973. And that's a serious threat indeed. And if you think the war in Gaza was 2014 was tough, look what the war might look like if we had to go to war against Hezbollah. Oh my.
So from your perspective, an ISIS-controlled Syria is preferable to leaving Assad in place where he can arm Hezbollah.
Nothing's preferable. I don't even want to put it in that. Life is choices. You know, if we had to face 100,000 rockets of Hezbollah, or a bunch of Salafists with machine guns, okay.
You'll take the Salafists with machine guns.
We'll have to deal with them too.
Okay. Can we go to the Twitter question on? Laura stepped aside.
Laura, you're the Twitter person.
There she is. Given the policy platform that you wrote for Kulanu, how can you sit in a government that's expanding settlements?
Because Kulanu was fashioned. Kulanu is the closest thing Israel has to a Jackson Democrat party.
And that's Scoop Jackson, you mean?
Scoop Jackson, yes. That is that we have a strong stance on diplomatic.
You know, we're having issues with our Andrew Jackson legacy right now.
You're the second person to say that. You mean Scoop Jackson? Why Andrew Jackson? Slavery, that stuff, killing Native Americans, that's now come up.
Who do you put on the $10 bill? You know.
Okay. I'm not Quran on this debate. Yeah, he had all those things. Also shot a lot of people in duels.
Yeah.
Scoop Jackson was sort of tough on defense, tough on diplomacy, tough on security, but he was very much conscious of social issues in this country. That's the closest thing we have in Israel would be the Kulanu Party. And why I was very much attracted to it. We ran on a platform that we weren't going to be in the coalition, that we would have joined a coalition that was headed by Netanyahu or a coalition that was headed by the Zionist camp under Bushi Herzog. So we ran as a government party because we had a social action program to reduce income gaps, which are some of the largest in the world, by the way. We're up there with Mexico and Chile.
Right.
An acute and pervasive housing shortage. Which is just, if you asked Israelis, by the way, in the polls, what was the greatest existential threat facing Israelis? It wasn't Iran, it was housing.
It's economics.
Yeah. So we were there, and we said we would join any coalition that would meet, Nate will give us the tools to fulfill our promises to our voters. We're trying to do it now. It's not easy because of the 61-59 split. We have the smallest coalition in Israel's history, except for one time under the first Rabin government, and it is, we are in constant filibuster. I pull all-night. Guys, I'm too old to pull all-nighters. Maybe you guys are, but you pull all-nighters? Oh. You know, I'll teach you something. You can now impress people at cocktail parties. You know how you say filibuster in Hebrew? Filibuster. And we have filibusterim all the time. They go on to 4, 5, 6 in the morning because they're trying, the oppositions, they know they're only 2 seats away from bringing down the government. You only need 2 people to collapse from exhaustion. You got it.
So the domestic issues for you are worth sitting in the government, even though on foreign policy or on policy toward Judea and Samaria, it's not your platform.
No, it is our platform. I don't know if I answered the question.
You suggested that Kulanu, in essence, made a trade-off, joining this government, prioritizing its domestic policy platform over its Palestinian policy platform.
No question about it. They weren't even, in the election, nobody was willing to talk about the Palestinians. Nobody. We have, we have debates. We had a debate like the Republican debate. The other night, the Republican debate, we have all these Republicans up there. All of our debates looked back together. We've got 20 people up there debating. And from all across the Israeli political spectrum, I think I was just about the only person even interested in talking about the Palestinian issue. The issues in the 2015 election were housing, were affordable wages, livable wages for the middle class.
Then why'd you get into the race, if you don't mind my asking?
Because I know, first of all, I've always been about service. That's what my whole life has been about service. And after you've been ambassador to the United States, where do you go? You got to, and politics is intriguing. Someone mentioned David Rothkopf before. He was my college roommate. That's why he wrote those nice things about my book. You should know. But toward the end of my time in Washington, he says, "Of course you're going into politics now." I said, "What, are you nuts? I have no political experience." He says, "What are you talking about? You've been here for 4.5 years. You've done nothing but politics. You've survived. Go into Israeli politics."
So you're saying it's David's fault. Now we know.
But the real reason is I know, Tamar, that the Palestinian issue is going to come back.
Mm-hmm.
And you know it too. It ain't going away. And it's going to be crucial for our relationship with the United States, for the relationship with Europe, who are our major trading partners. And yes, we will have to deal with housing prices, but eventually we're going to come back to this issue, and I'm hopefully here with a program that will work. I've talked about it in brief, but I call it the two-state situation, and I hope we can move on it.
Okay, we're going to do a lightning round, two more questions, and then we'll have to bring it to
a
close.
If you ask real quickly, I'll get them all, and I'll do it in an omnibus fashion.
Okay.
How are we doing?
How about that?
Okay.
Generous offer, one sentence each for the 6 of you who
are
in line. Go ahead.
Given the attitude that Mahmoud Abbas took toward the Oslo Accords in his speech at the UN today, do the achievements of the 1990s still matter as a structural framework for peace, or do we need to start over fresh somewhere else?
Okay. Go ahead. This
is a reference to your saying earlier that you'd love to bring a few buses of progressives to Israel to see the transgender community. I think that they would say, yes, that's wonderful, but you're not addressing the core issues of the conflict. Is there a conversation in Israel about ways to engage the progressive left, especially in light of this past year on the core issues of the conflict having, or have you, or as much of the Israeli population kind of said, let's move on?
Good question, thank you.
Yeah. Yep, go ahead.
Yeah, and assuming that Netanyahu remains in power, and the current frayed relations of the United States and Israel have, what would the United States have to do under the new president in 2016 to restore relations prior to the what you say they have?
Oh, good.
Great, thanks.
My name is Katie Corwin,
right,
and I'm a J Street U leader here on campus. And I was wondering, you said that Israel can be proactive in settlement freezes, but do you think that that could actually happen with this current coalition? And furthermore, what else can Israel do to end the occupation?
Okay, so if it can't happen, since you said it couldn't happen.
I think I said earlier that under the current coalition, it very, very difficult.
And so therefore, she's asking, what could Israel do to try and end the occupation given that?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
You talked about political space. It seems like the political space for a two-state solution is shrinking as sort of the far right and the far left sort of not only enable each other, and that sort of their space grows and sort of the middle shrinks. How do you sort of counteract that?
How do you counter polarization? Okay.
Polarization, political polarization in Israel? I'm sorry, I don't really understand the
in
end
Israel,
of the question.
In Israel, in the U.S.? Or
in
both?
Israel.
In Israel.
The way kind of Hamas and kind of the Israeli far right, I think, are they...
You said they were feeding off of each other.
Yeah.
Hamas and the Israeli far right.
No, I think that there are certain people on the Israeli far right would just assume deal with Hamas because they don't want a two-state solution. And they're willing to enter a prolonged ceasefire. For some people, that sounds pretty good. Not
right.
For me, but okay.
So if I understood your question, you're saying, can Israeli politics overcome that degree of polarization?
Yes, okay, good question. I get it.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Great. Yes, ma'am.
Maddie Frischer, freshman, School of International Service. As somebody who finds that I find both the Palestinian and the Israeli argument valid, how do you recommend you argue against situations where, in order to support Israel, you have to invalidate or feel like you have to invalidate the Palestinian situation?
That's a wonderful question. Thank you. Okay, let's see if we get these all together. Let's begin with ending the occupation. And I never use the O word in describing Israel's position in Judea and Samaria. These are our tribal lands. We can't occupy our own homeland, but I understand that we are ruling over another people, and I understand that the Palestinians regard it as an occupation, not only the Palestinians.
Well, the Israeli government and the Israeli army acknowledge that they are in occupation.
They don't use the actual term. Okay. They don't use the actual term, and I think it's important. I think words count. And the fact remains, about 90% of the Palestinians don't encounter Israeli troops on a daily basis. We can work to lay the groundwork for a two-state solution. That's the best I can say right now. Listen, the Middle East is in complete turmoil. The state system is unraveling. Tomorrow, if we could create a Palestinian state, what would it look like? It would have no national institutions. It would have no economy. It would have a corrupt, unelected leadership. How long do you think that state could survive? In the summer of 2014, it's not widely known here. In the summer of 2013, Hamas tried to overthrow Mahmoud Abbas. You know who saved him? We did. The IDF saved him. You want the IDF to withdraw from the West Bank tomorrow? He won't live the week. So we're not there yet. But that is not a formula for inaction. We can begin the process. It took the state of Israel a half a century to build the institutions on which the state could arise in May 1948. Didn't happen overnight. So we can call on our friends, our allies in the United States and Israel to help build those institutions. We can strengthen the Palestinian economy. We can increase freedom of movement, all sorts of freedoms we can increase to the degree that it's consonant with our security interests. And we can find win-win situations. Did I talk about Rawabi here?
No.
I've been in a lot of panel discussions. I don't want to sound... What? Louder? Okay. Rawabi. Rawabi is a town it's a project of a Palestinian
It's the first new Palestinian city.
It's the first new Arab city, by the way, since the 8th century. and since Ramla. And it's a great Palestinian city. It's got green environments. It's got wonderful apartments. It was ideal. The only problem is there was nobody in it. It was a ghost town. And it was a ghost town because it wasn't hooked up to the Israeli water grid. And we wouldn't hook it up to the water grid because the pipe would have to go through Area C, which according to the Oslo Accords, Palestinians couldn't build in. A pipe. And I argued throughout the campaign, hook up the damn pipe. Forget about the Oslo Accords for 2 seconds. Hook up the pipe. We have a win-win situation here, where we have Palestinians who want the good life for their kids, the good life for their grandkids. It belies the Palestinian narrative of oppression and suffering. We should have 20 Rawabis in the West Bank. Thank God, someone got smart, and a couple months ago they hooked up the water, and now people are moving into Rawabi. But that's what we can do. And that's being proactive, and it's working with Palestinian partners who want... It does not as if the people in Rawabi don't want a Palestinian state. They want a Palestinian state, and we have to give them the horizon for that Palestinian state, but before we reach the horizon and the Middle East stabilizes in some way, we can do an awful lot. I feel very ardent about that.
And in the meantime, these Oslo frameworks the Palestinian Authority, the Paris Agreement.
And listen, we really don't have any alternative to them right now. And after Mahmoud Abbas's speech, it's another big blow to them, and it creates a situation in Israel where we're saying, you know, there's no real partner out there. This man is not a partner. We don't know how much longer Mahmoud Abbas is going to stay in office. He's more than 80 years old. He's a heavy smoker. He's had serious ailments. We don't know what the next Palestinian leadership might look like. But I think it's the Oslo is still the best game in town. It's not a game that I think is the best. I don't think it's. I have always argued that the old Westphalian notion that representatives of two sides would sit by a table and sign a piece of paper and make an agreement, that's alien to the Middle East. The Middle East doesn't operate on Westphalian modes. It operates through implicit understandings, which is what, for example, that shipping of the Palestinian produce through Haifa. That's an understanding. It's nothing written there. That's how we actually work. That would be a different approach. And I think the Oslo approach, its problems lie in the fact that they ask both sides to do things which neither can do. Whereas we should be asking, what things can both sides do? It's a completely different approach. But right now, I think that the fact that we are engaged with a Palestinian leadership that says that it's committed to a two-state solution, that does recognize the state of Israel, that is something that we should not abandon. And I don't believe for those people that would rather have Hamas on the West Bank and negotiating with Hamas.
Two minutes on reaching out to American progressives and the next U.S. president.
I think, was that the question, reaching out to U.S. president? There was a last question I want to get
to. Yes, on polarization on the Israeli right, yeah.
On the?
Israeli right.
I think there was a different nuance to it. But okay, let's, reaching out to progressives, I think we have to reach out to progressives and show them what Israeli society looks like. And again, people don't know. I've been in Israel for close to 40 years. I've been in diplomacy, I've been in the military, I've been in government in various forms. I've never been in the legislature, never been in parliament. And I thought I knew the country very well, and it turns out I get in the Knesset and I find out I don't know this country at all. And that was shocking and illuminating and distressing. I brought Lindsey Graham to lunch at the Knesset. Lindsey Graham comes very often, he's the foreign affairs person, I brought him he had never been to Knesset. People don't go to Knesset. They go to see the prime minister, the defense minister. I brought him to Knesset. And I brought him into the plenary, which is our major assembly hall. And the discussion was on, get this, homophobia in the healthcare system. And a Christian, when we have several Christian members get up and talks about, you know, complains about homophobia in the healthcare system. Then a Druze man gets up there and yells at her. And someone from the right wing gets up and yells at both of them. And everyone's yelling. And if the seats weren't screwed to the floor, they throw the seat. And Lindsey was supposed to spend about 2-3 minutes. I couldn't get him to leave. He says, this is the most fascinating thing I've ever seen in my life. So this is like Israeli democracy. To show people Israeli democracy and the things we debate, a 2-hour drive from ISIS, folks. I mean, the drive from the Knesset to ISIS is shorter than the drive from Washington to Philadelphia. It is an amazing thing. But as I think as you were saying, where's the gentleman who asked the question? It's not enough. And I do think that on the progressive issue in particular, we have to show that we're taking initiatives on the Palestinians. I do. You know, even though it's not the pressing issue in Israel right now, it's a pressing issue among progressive Democrats. And we have to make that case as well. On the Iran issue, we really had no choice. Listen, we had something close to a national consensus on Iran. Very rare. We agree on nothing in Knesset. In the Knesset, just about everyone agreed this was a really bad deal. And it wasn't about politics. It was about our kids, our grandkids. And we had no choice to take the position we did. Some of the tactical issues that we discussed, whether this speech was the right speech or another speech, you're not going to go there. But on substance, there was almost no disagreement whatsoever, and I'm including behind closed doors. So there was a genuine difference between Israel and progressive Democrats. What can we say? And all the bus visits to the Knesset weren't going to change that. Sometimes differences are real differences. The one last question before you come up, Professor Bennett, there was a great question at the end I want to ask. It wasn't about polarization. What was the question again? Which he has clarified and retracted. Okay.
After the election. Anyway, and then, and, you know,
It does. But what's amazing, listen, starting in the year 2000 when we withdrew from Lebanon, and then in 2005 when we withdrew from Gaza, both of those areas became launching pads. To date, something like 20,000 rockets have been shot at Israel. Many, many times the number of V1 and V2 rockets fired by Nazi Germany at Britain during the course of all World War II. We've again and again faced a Palestinian leadership, quote unquote, moderate leadership in the West Bank that extols terrorists, extols suicide bombers, that accuses us of the worst crimes you can accuse a country in the world today, that refuses assiduously to negotiate with us. And yet when you look at the polls in Israel, you still see a solid majority in favor of a two-state solution. That is the incredible thing. That is the extraordinary thing, that the majority of the Israeli public, that I can walk out and say, I support the two-state solution, I support freezing outside the blocks, and not have people ridicule me. Never mind, you know, chase me out of town on a rail. That I can go to communities around the state of Israel, and Israelis still believe, albeit with healthy skepticism, and I think of experience-born skepticism, that peace is someday possible. And it's essential for those of us who have, you know, young children or young grandchildren. We don't want them to have to fight the wars that we fought. When my first son was born, the first thing I said to the obstetrician, that kid's not going to wear a helmet. 18 years later, he wore a helmet, and he was wounded, as you know, Dan, shot at close range, fighting Hamas. I don't want his kid. He's got a little baby now. I don't want that kid to wear a helmet. We have to have this. And the fact that the Israelis, in spite of our experience, very rare, look at the way these two wars have impacted American opinion in this country, the war weariness, in which I don't know how many people actually fought in Iraq and Afghanistan, but this place is weary. Try experiencing major wars every 2 years and having rockets fired on your neighborhood and have your kids running for bomb shelters. Try still being in favor of peace after all that. And if you ask me, that is one of the miraculous accomplishments of the state of Israel, that we haven't abandoned the vision.
No. Well, folks, I think Michael's generosity with his time is evidence of how much he relishes